Now we're going to talk about other pituitary diseases that are the incidentaloma and pituitary adenomas. The most common pituitary adenoma is going to be a prolactinoma. A pituitary tumor that produces no symptoms. If the incidentaloma is less than 1 centimeter, the treatment is just observation, is taking yearly a MRI to see if the mass has increased in size, and taking prolactin levels, because the most common cause of a pituitary adenoma is if it is an adenoma that is secreting some hormone, is a prolactinoma. So for that, we will take prolactin levels. If it is more than 1 centimeter, larger than 1 centimeter, yearly the MRI, the prolactin levels, but also TSH, T4, FSH, LH, and insulin-like growth factor, and the visual test in order to see if the patient has bitemporal hemianopsia. Now, the pituitary adenomas, usually they are non-functional, but they produce symptoms because the invasion, that is, they are compressing the optic chiasm, and so they produce bitemporal hemianopsia, for example. Now, if we have a secreting adenoma, the most common cause is a prolactinoma. So, how are we going to diagnose a prolactinoma? The prolactin is in the only hormone that produces lactation, so the woman will present with milky discharge from the breast, and remember that prolactin inhibits the ovulation, inhibits the FSH and LH, so the patient will not be menstruating. They have decreased libido. In man, just would be the decreased libido, sometimes impotence. So usually would be noted first in woman than in man. If the prolactinoma is very big, then it can compress the optic chiasm, and so the patient will have bitemporal hemianopsia. Usually bitemporal hemianopsia is seen in man because man doesn't have the primary symptoms or the early symptoms of FSH and LH, and so the disease advanced and the patient came already with the bitemporal hemianopsia, and for that is going to the physician office. But a woman would come because there are months in which the woman is not menstruating. She will come for this instead of the bitemporal hemianopsia, because this presents first. The treatment with the prolactinoma is, if we can resect it, yes, we can resect it. But remember, this is the only tumor that we do not resect in endocrino. First, if we can treat it with medication, we treat it with medication. The medications are dopamine antagonist, because remember that dopamine decreases the release of prolactin. So if we give dopamine, dopamine agonist, we will decrease the release of prolactin. So the agonists of dopamine are bromocriptine and carbegoline. We usually give carbegoline just because produces less side effects, but in efficacy they have the same efficacy. If we cannot treat it with this, then we try to resect it, transfemoral resection. And if there is no other choice, we do radiation therapy. Now, there are other causes of prolactin. Prolactin could be a side effect of medications that, for example, are antagonists of the dopamine, because so we are inhibiting the inhibition of prolactin, and so we are stimulating the production of prolactin. This would be typical and atypical antipsychotics. Typical antipsychotics would be, for example, aripiprazole. Atypical antipsychotics would be risperidone. Other dopamine blockers like metoclopramide, some antihypertensive medications like reserpine or calcium channel blockers, but calcium channel blockers will be verapamil. Remember that verapamil only has effect in the heart and is the only calcium channel blocker that produces prolactin. Prolactin secretion or hyperprolactinemia. The phenothiazines that are chlorpromazine or prochlorpromazine. The drugs that are cocaine or some narcotics and physical problems that produces increase in the prolactin is if we compress the stalk of the pituitary, then we are inhibiting the dopamine arriving to the pituitary, and so there will be no dopamine that we in the release of prolactin. So these are other causes of hyperprolactinemia that we need to rule out before seeing the prolactinoma. So first we ask about these medications, and if there is no history of this, then we proceed with the MRI. And in the MRI, we should see the increase in size. Also, how much is the hyperprolactinemia? The hyperprolactinemia is usually more than 100. The normal prolactin levels is less than 20, but usually the diagnosis is more than 100. Usually it could be more than 200. If it is a prolactinoma, usually it would be less than 150, and hyperprolactinemia with other causes could be above 150.